Hello, and welcome to another Biohack Chat. I'm your host, as always, Justin. Welcome to the show. We got a very special one for you today. We're going to be talking with a friend of mine, Mixael Laufer, Dr. Mixael Laufer. He's a pretty cool guy. He does a lot of really cool stuff, so I think we're going to be able to cover some pretty fun ground. He is the head of the Four Thieves Vinegar Collective, and we're going to talk a lot about that. Ought to be a lot of fun. As always, you'll see that there is a donation bar right here. Donations go to help, you know, keeping making videos, doing the thing. So all donations are appreciated. And one last quick announcement before we get going. This is going to be probably the last stream on the main channel. Starting in the new year, all the streams are going to be moving onto a second channel. There'll be a whole announcement video, but I just wanted to give you a heads up that all of the streams are going to get moved off of this channel onto that one. Now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce my guest, Mixael. You should be on now. There we are. Okay.
Great, cool. Yeah. How are you holding up back in the Americas? The numbers coming out of there don't look too encouraging.
I mean, thankfully, I'm in you know, Yield, Canuckistan. It's cold, and, you know, the numbers are definitely higher than I would like, but it's definitely not as bad as our southern neighbors.
Indeed. That one's terrifying.
Yeah, just a little. I mean, my city has been locked down for more than 2 months now, and now they're like the numbers haven't really gone down because they're doing the, if we pretend that we keep it, like, schools aren't one of the main transmission factors, then they won't be, which last I checked, that's not how anything works. So
yeah, I'm not sure I quite track on that one either. Yeah,
so that's a little rough, but you know, they're about to lock down things even harder. So, I mean, after Christmas, everything is getting just, like, hard lockdown. And, I mean, the numbers are going to be horrifying. At one point, they were thinking of doing, like, a four-day break from lockdown. They're like, you could have 4 days off for Christmas. And everyone's like, are you, what? What do you mean? But, yeah, so that's exciting. You're in Singapore these days, yeah?
I am indeed. And it's nice and safe here. Our numbers have been basically zero for weeks. We occasionally get imported cases from places that we still let fly in, but it's been handled very well. In the entirety of the pandemic, we've had roughly 58,000 cases total. Wow. And while we are a small country, the number of deaths that you would imagine, just if you imagine a number, you say 58,000 cases, how many people you expect to die? We've had 27 deaths total.
Wow. That's...
So there's a combination of factors that have led to all of that going so well. All of the measures in place have been very strict. Culturally, people adhere to, you know, health and safety of the general populace and well-being, and the medical infrastructure here is very strong. So,
well, that's I mean, as these things go, that's pretty solid. That is pretty
solid. Yeah, I mean, and you've seen it happen in a couple of other places where it's been handled very well. Taiwan, New South Zealand, Korea. Iceland. Ireland was doing okay for a while, too. And, you know, places that are generally isolated, island nations.
yeah, anything that can, like, cut off its border. Like, Canada can't. Like, we're basically screwed because we literally can't close our border, and we have, like, this seeping cesspool just slightly south of that's just constantly leaking cases in. So no, like, it doesn't really matter how hard we lock things down, they just keep coming in. So it's, I mean, it is the way it is. There's nothing we can really
well Nova Scotia's doing pretty well, but kind of the same reason, because they isolated separately.
Yeah. I mean, none of it was doing great until it wasn't.
Right.
I mean, that's kind of the thing, right? Like, it gets pandemic. You get one case and it just spreads.
Yeah, it's funny too, as you might know, I was chair of a math department for a while in California, and I've been getting messages from old students saying, I'm desperately looking for my notes from your math class where you were jumping up and down screaming about Ebola spreading and how dangerous viruses were. And I was like, I wasn't kidding.
Yeah, I mean,
nice we didn't notice.
We've been talking about plague event for a long time, and we're like, yeah, no, it's coming at some point. And then it happened, and it's just as not fun as we expected. Who'd have thought?
Right. Yeah.
So, you know, it is the way it is. But so speaking of you know, disease and how it's treated, tell me more about the Four Thieves Vinegar Collective. What's your deal? What do you guys get up to? What's the TLDR?
Well, in general, we're a human rights and global health anarchist collective, and the general goal is to bring medicines and medical technologies to people who need it but don't have it. We released a survival guide to COVID back in February that's aged reasonably well. There are a couple of things that we didn't have sort of complete information, but most of the advice is pretty good. For people who like to listen rather than read, there's also a radio drama version that we posted on YouTube that was read by a friend of ours very well, which was fun. And we have not been focusing much on COVID in the interim because all of the problems that we have been focusing on, have been trying to address, haven't gone away in the interim. And it's really rather unfortunate because suddenly the world is much more health conscious, which is a good thing. However, at the same time...
Well, it's health conscious about one specific thing.
Right. And that's kind of the glitch.
Right.
And one of the phenomena that is analogous is that when you think of a war zone, typically you think of bombs and landmines and bullets being the problem. But if you look at any conflict zone or war zone, as they should be properly called, the main causes of death are non-infectious chronic disease. Things like diabetes, hypertension, heart disease, kidney failure, and those are not addressed.
Right. And I mean, it's all the stuff that's always got to be taken care of, and then all of a sudden it's just not.
Right. And that's and the interesting thing about looking at death in a war zone is that the war is still the thing that's killing people. It's just not killing them directly. Because people don't have access to infrastructure and health support, then, I mean, if you're being shelled all day, every day, how do you get insulin, even if there was insulin to be had to start with, which is a whole other question. But it is still the phenomenon of the war that is the problem, but it's the secondary effects. And I think that while people are worried about coronavirus directly, the real danger is looking at all of the secondary things that it's causing, and not just the long tail terrifying things of the fact that it seems to, you know, cause all of these ancillary organ failures and nobody really understands why, but additionally just very simple things that are flying under the radar. I continue to wonder how many people have died from opiate withdrawal because their you know, access pipeline has been interrupted.
I mean, here they're canceling surgeries because the hospitals are so full. So it's like, oh, you've got cancer. Well, that's great, but you're going to have to wait.
Yeah, which is never a good idea.
Or I mean, there was another one where people just weren't going to the hospital, even though they needed to, because they were so afraid of getting sick if they went in. Which is, it's kind of a, I mean, it's fucked. Like, there's no better word. It's just awful.
Yeah.
So, you know, that is kind of horrifying. So just quickly, we did have a donation. Thank you, Andrew Erickson. He says, constant glucose monitor, please.
Would be interesting. Constant glucose monitor. Oh, yeah. Let's totally talk about constant glucose monitors.
Okay.
So there are a number of them on the market, and there are a number of problems. The big problem with the glucose monitors is that they are typically closed source systems. So most companies that produce glucose monitors of whatever type want to make the best version, try and get their corner on the market. And so it's this black box.
Right.
This is a problem, of course, A, because it means that you're trusting their system that you can't audit, which has all of the myriad problems that it normally does. Second, the problem is that you don't have any ancillary control. So you can't audit and you can't control. Third problem, because you can't control, then you can't integrate it with an insulin pump, which is what you'd ideally like to do, right? What you'd like to have happen is you'd like to have an insulin pump that would react to your glucose monitor in real time.
Okay. I mean,
and give you a nice, even blood sugar level the way it would if your pancreas were functioning.
Right. I mean, like, you want a pancreas box, really. But without, if it's all closed source, there's no way to make the two things talk to each other, and so you literally can't. You just have to look at the thing, hope the number's right, and if you trust it, do what you gotta do.
And there's a fourth problem, which is that because of FDA regulations, and please check this if this is something you're going to look into, because I am not an expert on these particular regulations, but as I understand it, any insulin pump is not allowed to predictively react to data that it gets from a glucose monitor. It can only react to real-time absolutes. So here's what it can do. You can have a glucose monitor and an insulin pump hooked up and then go to sleep. And if it gets, you know, if things get dangerous, the insulin pump can intervene, but not until it crosses some critical threshold. What you'd like to do is you'd like to have it look at the derivative, right? That there's this, oh, it's trending. Oh, my glucose is spiking. And before it gets into some state that's actually dangerous, maybe trickle in a little bit of insulin so that it sort of logarithmically tops out before it's a problem. So, I mean,
this comes back to, we want a pancreas box. Like, we want it to behave like a pancreas, which it
exactly
can't. Like, if they want to do like PID, which is not as smooth. It's just it's hit a level, respond, do a thing, respond, like wait for data, then like there's no, but I mean, I suppose I understand the theoretical argument behind not letting you do that, because what if it's wrong, right? Like if it misjudges and gives you like a huge shot of insulin and now you're dead, like that's no good.
That would be no good, but again, this is not a really complicated problem, and it's been well studied for a long time.
I don't think that's a realistic issue. I think argument that they make.
Right, that is the rhetoric that they espouse, and the problem is that, like, even what you describe is better than what you get with the current systems. They don't even do PID. It's, you can't do anything to cross this line. Then when you cross this line, then you can react.
Interesting. Okay.
And if you look at the people who've been working on the artificial pancreas project, this is exactly the thing that they've been trying to crack. Mm-hmm. And the magic of it is that if you just do that very basic PID predictive analysis, you can have something that is a much closer approximation of the functioning of the pancreas instead of something that just sort of dumps to keep you alive.
Right. Like, and instead of the stories, the spikes.
Right. And the stories that I've heard about diabetics who've been able to sleep through the night for the first time in their entire lives because they don't have to wake up and dose is just like, it. I mean, it's hard not to get emotional over it because it's so...
Man, diabetes is scary. I mean, not to be fair, I'm a hypochondriac on the best of days, but like there's definitely a few conditions that I'm like, I don't want it.
Like, yeah.
I got enough shit going on that doesn't work right. I don't need a broken pancreas on top of it. Like, it just, although, I mean, for me, then, like, so there was this really interesting bit of genetic engineering. They did it to a mouse, because of course, where they built a insulin circuit that was on a glucose sensitive promoter. So it would trigger trigger insulin production once glucose hit a certain threshold. So basically, if you were to modify some cells in your leg, it basically turns your leg into a pancreas, which I think is very neat. Of course, you know, getting that circuit to behave and not... I mean, it's genetic circuits. Like, getting that not to throw an error and, like, either throw way too much or not enough is fiddly, but I like the idea in theory. Right. Like, I think it's the sort of thing, if they could, like, get the control circuit to be clean enough and consistent enough, that could be amazing. But, I mean, until then,
yeah, we're stuck. Yeah, I mean, that's the dicey thing with gene therapies, right? Because they're... You kind of put them in, you let them off the leash, and they work or they don't.
Yeah.
In terms of that sort of thing, the much more encouraging therapies are, you know, signaling mechanisms. If you can get into the guts and find a signaling mechanism, then it's something that you can modulate so that you still have things being produced endogenously.
Right.
But you can regulate it by dosage level. Right. So you can actually say, oh yeah, a little more, a little less, and then you can tweak it you know, ex vivo while you're working on it. But your viewer specifically asked about glucose monitors. There's another technology in glucose monitoring that's exciting and is super ripe for hacking. Speaking of hacking, for people out there, if you're the type of people who can crack encryption, take a look at some of these glucose monitor insulin pump systems. And if you can crack the encryption on there, that would give some really cool tools to some of the people who are hacking those systems.
I mean, do you have an example? Like if you could get that data, what do you do with it?
Well, if you can get that data, then so for any of the systems that are on the market, then if you can crack the encryption, then you can control those systems directly. And then you can run that sort of predictive algorithm that will allow a sort of artificial pancreas to be encoded into the system rather than just a fail safe that maybe keeps you from, you know, suffering too badly or dying.
Right. Interesting.
So there's another glucose monitoring technology that's fairly new, but I see it around more and more, which is actually an implant that's not unlike the form factor of like an implanted RFID chip. And it tends to go on the back of the arm, and then you have a unit that sticks on over your skin and communicates, I mean, it powers the implant inductively and monitors your blood glucose and then sends that wirelessly to the rest of your system. Again, it still has the same problem that it's all closed source and encrypted and blah, blah, blah. But what's really cool is that instead of having something that's breaching the skin, right, and so you have this port, you have this thing that can sit under your skin for 90 days. And
it's only 90 days.
So this is the part that's a little exciting, right? So the thing is that it's only 90 days, but the reason why it's only 90 days is not entirely clear. It seems as though the 90-day limit is based on regulatory issues, not based on technical or health issues. As far as I can tell, and again, this is very incomplete data, so if anybody has better information, like, send it over. But from what we've been able to determine, the reason that it only works for 90 days is that getting licensing for something to be approved for 90 days has a certain regulation. Once you get past that, then the regulations go way up and it's harder to create something that's for that. There are a couple of little technical things. Right. I mean, I assume that when you have something that's designed to be implanted for longer, like a pacemaker or an artificial heart, then the fail-safe systems and the redundancy that you have to build in has to be much more robust. Again, I assume this is not something that we've managed to get any good data on.
Right. And also, however, because then they can make arguments about, you know, what happens if the meter fouls or any of that kind of, like, because I mean, I know that's a problem with glucose fuel cells. Because I mean, for me, like, I love the idea of implanted tech, right? Like, in theory, it's great, with the caveat that, I mean, A, batteries are finite, and B, how the hell do you charge it? And most people's answer has either been nuclear battery or inductive charging. Nuclear batteries are very expensive, and they come with their own problems, primarily self-explanatory, I feel.
The main problem with the nuclear battery is that it's very low current.
It's also low current. Right, it's very low current. Like, the beta voltaics just suck. Like, they're great in theory.
They're very specific. If you want something that's going to chirp every day, that's okay.
But to run,
if
like a heart, something that's gonna not so be, much.
Yeah, no.
So then you get into, like, the glucose fuel cells, which is theoretically, as long as you keep eating, it's got power. But same problem, like getting that to run at body temperature and also produce enough power to be useful is hard. And also, you kind of got to put it where the glucose is, which means blood, which inherently means it, like, not only does it need to be biocompatible, it needs to be hemocompatible, which is like a whole nother set of problems, because your immune system, like, it's more exposed to the immune system. There's stuff flowing through. If something gets clogged on there, now you got a clot and you got a problem. Like, it's just an extra set of design challenges. Especially, like, if you want a fuel cell, it needs high surface area. High surface area is more fouling. Like, it's you know, how do you get around this? Also, your material choices are hyper limited because body. So basically, you're left with, like, a carbon and platinum. And very little else, and certain plastics.
There are a few others, but yeah. So the thing that's fascinating to my mind is that with this type of implantable tech, two things are potentially possible from sort of the from the biohacking angle. One is that perhaps somebody technically inclined will figure out how to unbrick them and use them in conjunction with other things. So you have something that resets the 90-day clock or doesn't, you know, start the 90-day clock, and then you can use it with other hardware. and or the technology could simply be hijacked and manufactured separately. And then you could make your own implantable glucose monitor that you could use your own, and then you wouldn't have to deal with hacking somebody else's system.
Right. Although, I mean, so, making, like, that's always, especially with something implantable, that's always harder.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, like, the stuff that the, like, biohackers tend to make to implant is inherently fairly simplistic or gigantic. Although, I mean, you have a... Or do you still have your interesting little implant? You want to talk about that?
Yes, yeah, it's not that little, but yeah, it's still in my bag.
You're right; it's not that little. It was, that thing is chunky.
Yeah, it's a little bigger than I guess maybe 3-4 sticks of gum. I think that that's a testament to the fact that if you want to build some sort of an implant, it's entirely accessible.
I mean, within reason. It depends what you're making. Like, a glucose monitor is inherently tricky because you've got to have something exposed to the fluids. If you want something that's just totally encapsulated, that's a little easier. So, like, can you tell everybody what your implant is?
Yeah, so it's a half terabyte local area network and pirates server. So when I spin it up, it creates just an open Wi-Fi network. You can log in with, you know, anything that's Wi-Fi enabled. There's a chat room, there are forums, there's a repository of files, and you can upload and download and stream. And it also anonymizes everything, so everything has, you know, the metadata stripped, so when people interact or things are uploaded, there's no way to audit to see where it came from or what occurred. So it's also a safety net. I'm not the only person who has it,
right?
There, we've made a total of, I don't know, 7 or 8 of them, and they're out there. One of the things also that it allows for in the sort of, like, you know, romantic cyberpunky thing is that you can act as a totally anonymous data courier. So say for a moment, somebody wants to very securely move data from one place to another. And let's, you know, assume for a moment that going from one place and being in public places was not dangerous.
Yeah, let's pretend this was a year and a half ago where you could just go places and it was fine.
Yeah, so when I got it put in...
wasn't that a magical time?
Yes, it was. So the sort of thing that you would be able to do in theory, I will neither confirm nor deny whether this has actually occurred, but what you could do is if somebody wanted to securely move data from one place to another, from one person to another, it could be so very anonymous that this person could make a deal with you that as a data courier, what you would do is you would go into a public place, a cafe or whatever, sit down, power up your peg leg just for a set period of time. And somebody within the radius of the network would upload their file, and it can be encrypted. So you don't know who it was, and you don't know what it is, and you don't have any access to it yourself, but you do carry it. And then, similarly, at some other appointed place and time, you can sit in a public area, spin up the peg leg, and then because people can, again, anonymously download whatever happens to be on your file system there, then somebody who knew what they were looking for could download it. And then theoretically they have a decryption key and can unpack that file.
I mean,
and again, you don't know who any of these people were, so...
I spent my day playing Cyberpunk, that is the most Cyberpunk thing I've heard all day. And
oh, excellent. Man.
No, that's, I mean, it's pretty wild. I think it's one of the, so how long has that been in now?
It's over a year. This was at DEF CON last year. So I guess it was last August.
Oh, okay. So yeah, so, it's been yeah, a good long while. Yeah, so a couple of questions, because these are always the same questions I get. I did a video about magnet implants, and I always get the same questions, which are like, you know, what if you got to go to an MRI? What if you got to go through the airport? I mean, you're in Singapore. You had to go through the airport. Did it set off the detector?
So I traveled a lot with that thing.
Okay.
And it varies. So some places have their act together security-wise a little better than others, and some less so. So in places where security is merely theater, it's fairly easy to slip by unnoticed. Traveling the U.S. usually wasn't much of a problem.
Yeah. all of the things that have been transported in... There's so many hilarious stories of things that got just transported via airports. I mean, I feel like there was some fairly hilarious stories from, like, Hunter S. Thompson that I definitely cannot tell on a live stream.
Right. Well, that also was a bygone era, but even in
even recently, like, I have friends who have brought, you know, biologicals on, like, you know, just in their pocket. They had, like, a pocket full of cryo vials of, like, hex cells or whatever.
I carried a, like, really ominous looking hard case full of stab cultures that, like, nobody asked me about. Oh, this funny. Was DEF CON 3 years
was this
ago.
Was this the mouth bacteria thing?
It was the predecessor to the mouth bacteria, yeah.
Did that never got working, yeah? As far as I know, I don't know anybody who's managed to get it working.
Well, stay tuned.
Oh, really?
Because
we had that construct made, and we could not get it into the bacteria.
I can't give a lot of detail, but that barrier has been passed.
Oh, really?
And neat. Yes. So, stay tuned, and hopefully we will have good news in the new year.
Good news, everyone. Yeah, that'd be great.
Yes.
That was an interesting one, because it's I want to say gram negative, maybe gram, I don't know, whatever. It's the opposite of whatever E. coli is.
Right.
So when we tried getting that construct made, we were just following the paper as written. Also, just for people who, I'm just referencing things that I haven't actually explained. The thing I'm referencing is there's a species of bacteria that is normally found in your mouth, or can be found in your mouth, but...
It's found in everybody's mouth.
If you're over
the age of a year and a half.
Yeah, but it's highly competitive. Like, it'll outcompete most things. But the idea is, if you can knock out its lactic acid production and instead replace it with ethanol, you won't get cavities, because your mouth won't end up acidic. So I tried doing this, couldn't get it working. Admittedly, I was messing with this when I was still fairly inexperienced with genetic modification. I feel like if I actually, like, gave a shit and gave, like, tried now, I could probably do it. But, like, also the original paper was not accurate. Like, I remember reading it, and there was all kinds of stuff that just doesn't track. Like, some of the instructions.
Well, it's fairly old technology too.
Well, that was
20-year-old paper. So.
That was the thing. It was a very old paper, and they were, like, using, like, monk bean phosphatase and stuff. And we're like, what? Who uses? Nobody uses this anymore.
Right.
And so, you know, I think that was kind of the downfall of that. But it's you know, it's an interesting project. I'm glad somebody got it working.
Yeah, so...
I mean, I'm interested to see if it actually does the thing that it claims, which is no more plaque. or no more cavities, but
because no more that, cavities, it's a different thing.
It's not no more plaque. It's no more cavities. Two very different bacteria. If you could do no more plaque, though, that would be.
Well, you work on that and get back to me, okay?
Yeah, right. That one's hard. That one's real. Hey, I went the other way. I'm like turning plaque into like chunks of rock to like grow buildings with. Okay, cool. So that one was a neat one. I'm glad that's going somewhere. So we've talked about peg leg. We've talked about the weird mouth bacteria. What are you, you've done a lot of really interesting stuff. Like, should we talk about the pyrimethamine? Should we talk about the little micro lab thing, the EpiPencil? What do you want to talk about? Unless you've got something else that's burning that you want to talk about.
Well, I mean, we can talk about newer stuff too. Sure. I mean, we've got a couple more things.
What's brewing?
So, we've got a couple new projects, one of which is we're working on an open source AED. So basically anybody who has a sudden heart attack and goes into VTAC or VFib, if you have a defibrillator nearby, with basically no training, you can stick some stickers on somebody, press a button, and they kind of come back to life. Like, it's almost like in the movies.
Right.
But if you don't have access to that, they die. And basically, mortality rates go up by about 10% every minute that passes between when the heart attack happens and when you get the defibrillator to them.
Well, heart attack or cardiac arrest? Because they're different.
Right. So, sorry, it's sudden cardiac arrest.
There we go. The heart stuff is something I've become intimately familiar with in the last year or so. So I did not know that there was a difference until I had to actually look this up. So just for clarity for people watching, a heart attack is when you have something that like clogs your heart, like there is a blockage. Right. Whereas cardiac arrest is your heart is not beating properly, like it's an electrical problem, which is why if you're having a heart attack, they tend to give you like epi or something, and also then you got to get into surgery, get the clog out. Whereas if it's cardiac arrest...
There are a lot of things that need to happen there.
Yeah, there's a lot of things that got to happen. Whereas cardiac arrest, you shock them and you're good. It just resets.
Right, if you have a heart attack, like the heart cramps, and then it's like, well, this isn't going to be long. But if you merely have something that's not responding to the usual electrical pulses, or the electrical pulses are going nuts, you can restart that, and it's a pretty easy fix. There's a guy who has, I think, the world record for greatest number of saves, and he's like a manager at a subway station in London, I think.
Okay.
And he has more saves than like any paramedic or anybody anywhere, just because he knows how to recognize sudden cardiac arrest. He's got an AED on the wall and can grab it and use it. And he's done this, you know, some ridiculous number of times. Hmm. And so
and I guess he's in a high traffic area where like statistically there's lots of people coming through all the time.
Exactly. You know, and in high stress environment, period of time when people are most likely to, you know, undergo that sort of thing, mid morning, blah, 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 blah. So yeah, like all of the statistics are in his favor. And so when you think about this from sort of a public health perspective, what you'd really like to do is just put an AED stands for automatic external defibrillator. And so if you're not familiar with these, for the people who are viewing, it's totally automated. You basically open somebody's shirt, you put two stickers on, and you start the thing. It does an EKG to see if the heart needs a shock. It talks you through CPR. If it needs to say a shock, it tells you to stand back and press the button, and it delivers the shock, and then it'll continuously reassess the situation. These should be in every public business and in every home and in every public space. They should just be everywhere. In wealthy areas and in wealthy businesses. You'll see them sometimes, like on mounted on walls.
I mean, but what do they cost?
Well, that's the problem, right?
Right.
They are, if you get the bargain basement ones, they're about $3,000 US. And so most people don't have that to just
sorry,
drop
that took me a second thing. For that number to hit. My brain heard 300 and then it added the extra zero and went, oh.
Yeah. Right. And so because of this, right, there aren't a lot of people who go out and decide to privately own a defibrillator for what intuitively feels like an unlikely event, even though it's not. And if you look at the statistics for people who undergo sudden cardiac arrest, most of them have no prior heart conditions and no prior symptoms, and it just happens, and then you die if the ambulance doesn't get to you within a few minutes. But when you look at it from an engineering standpoint, it's really only about $500 worth of parts. So where's the big glitch? Well, the big glitch is in intellectual property law,
and the bells and whistles, right? Like they say that, you know, well, it's got to have the fancy computer that's going to talk you through the thing, and it's all proprietary, blah, 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 blah. But like,
not even that though.
But like, hardware wise, it's not actually a complicated thing. I mean, an EKG you can get for almost nothing.
Right.
Like the actual zappy bit is not a complicated circuit at all.
Indeed not. So,
I mean,
interesting
like when,
thing,
like when they say like, you know, charging, it's literally it's a capacitor. Like it charges up the capacitor to a voltage. And you go, okay, put the pointy end on the patient, and just
right.
Bang, like it's exactly what it is.
So 3 years ago, there's a gentleman by the name of Jacopo Ferretti who was doing his master's in biomedical engineering, and he just designed this with two other people, and he engineered it beautifully. To the point where if you wanted to utilize this design to like start your own AED business, it's regulable. So you could push it through FDA or wherever else you happen to live in the world. And it's an approvable. It has all of the redundancies and safeties that you would get from a commercial unit. And it only costs $500 to make. Now, the thing that's a little sad is that this was 3 years ago and nobody's heard of it. So we stumbled across it and contacted them and said, would you like to partner? We're pretty good at getting things out to the public. And they said, sure. So what we're doing now is we're trying to put together some updated documentation. And we're also trying to do some walkthroughs so that people who aren't super technically inclined but would like to have one can go through and build their own. And then for, you know, maybe a day's worth of tinkering and work and $500, you could build your own AED, and then you'll have one in your house. Hopefully, you know, probability smiles on you and you never have to use it.
Yeah.
But in the event that you're not so lucky, you don't have to just sit there and watch somebody you love die.
Right.
So that's a really exciting project. We're hoping to get that rolling fairly soon. We have another one that we talked about at DEF CON. And that one is the subdermal plastic drug delivery system.
Okay. Tell me more. I haven't heard of this.
So the biggest challenge for medications in general is adherence, right? The place where medication fails is people don't take it or they don't take it properly. And this becomes especially touchy in any events where you have to take something every day, and under specific conditions. A really classic example of this, right, is just birth control, right? Birth control is something you have to take every day. You need to take it around the same time every day. But there's so many ways that can go wrong, right? You sleep in, you're hungover, you forget how I took it today, did I take it yesterday? And there are systems for keeping that, but maybe you had the flu and you threw it up. Any number of things could go wrong. And then risk starts to spike for pregnancy. And the same thing is the case for all sorts of medications that are things that you take perpetually for chronic conditions or right. preventative conditions. So pre-exposure prophylaxis is a good example as well. Antiretrovirals for people who are HIV infected is another example.
Yeah.
Even things that aren't perpetual but are just long-term. Sovaldi, one of the most incredible medications ever developed that cures hepatitis C, you got to take a pill every day with two other medications for 12 weeks. And if you mess that up, it doesn't work and your hepatitis C doesn't go away.
Could end up treatment resistant, yeah?
I don't have data on that. I'm not sure.
I feel like it might not be necessarily a huge concern, but it's definitely one of those on the list of things that might happen.
It's certainly possible, right? I don't know if that's been documented yet or how well that's been investigated, but it's certainly a concern.
Right. At the very least, you still would still end up with Hep C, which the whole point was to get rid of it. So
right, which is no picnic. And yeah. And so the piece of data that I do know is that of the people who are given a course of Sovaldi, 60% don't complete it, which is kind of mind-blowing from so many angles, not the least of which is the fact that the pills are $1,000 a piece. And so...
$1,000 a day?
Yes. And that's not including the supporting medications. That's just...
Wait, is this... Hold up. Is this American prices or is this like actual prices?
Sorry. So, I know that is the situation in the U.S.
I'm more Canadian, civilized countries. Like, what's this actually cost?
So, in reality, yes. In more civilized countries where the government actually cares about their constituency...
Or at least has to pretend.
Right. These things are more in an affordable realm. But yeah, okay. in the U.S. at least, you're talking about $82,000 out of pocket.
Jesus.
Just for the Sovaldi, to say nothing of the doctor's visits to administer them, to say nothing of the supporting medications of antivirals you need to take with it, et cetera, et cetera.
That's bonkers.
So, if you have, and of course there are great programs that are trying to subsidize it and trying to get it out to people who are incarcerated, and they're all doing really great work, but still you have this problem of adherence where if right. somebody misses a couple doses in a row and their viral load spikes, it's kind of over. All that work that you put into trying to eradicate this from somebody's body. It's just down the drain. So if instead of saying, all right, now make sure you come back tomorrow and every day for the next 12 weeks to somebody and make sure it's around the same time, et cetera, et cetera. And if you could instead say, well, just hang on a second. We're going to put this piercing needle under your skin for a minute. And we're going to leave this little piece of plastic there and come back in 12 weeks. Or don't, because it's perfectly biocompatible and you'll be fine. And you know that the hepatitis C will go away.
Yeah, that does sound a lot better.
And so many other things that it's...
I mean, there's a ton of things that would be... Yeah, like you say, there's a million things that could be useful for. I mean, there's so many, like, short-term... I mean, imagine if antibiotics were given that way instead of with pills. Because the number of people who... will stop taking the antibiotics as soon as they feel better is just right. awful. And that's how we end up with this frickin' antibiotic apocalypse problem. Like, everybody's getting all freaked out about COVID. I'm like, y'all don't even have any idea what's coming. Just wait until, like, you can get the actual plague again.
I mean, and that's not even the beginning of it, you know? There's so many more.
Yeah. I mean, personally, I'm a big fan of, like, phage therapy, but that's neither here nor there.
It's here. I'm a huge fan of phage therapy, and I think it's absolutely criminal that it's not being used more.
Yeah. Well, to be clear, I'm right there with you. When I say it's neither here nor there, it's not available.
Right. I mean, you know, you could go to Russia maybe and talk with some.
There's a major clinic in Georgia, not the state, the country.
Do you have friends there? Can you introduce me?
I don't. I know of the clinic because I'm a huge fan of phage therapy, and I looked this up at one point. It was one of those, you know, I looked it up thinking, you know, if I'm fucked and I have to use this, I'd like to know where I gotta go. And basically the way it works is you contact them and you tell them what you've got, and they check their library and figure out if they've got something that'll work for you. And if not, you have to somehow get them a sample of some sort. I don't know what the specifics, like, I don't know how this works. But you get them some amount of sample so that they can cook you up a phage ready to go, and then you fly out, do your therapy, and come home.
That's awesome. Yeah, well, we need to have that.
Yeah, right? Like, this magical thing that fixes any bacterial problem.
But you have to have that library, and you have to be able to track it down. But,
yeah. Although, yeah. I mean, the nice thing is it's very rare that a bacterial infection kills you quickly. Like, it's usually a slow burn, unless it's something real aggressive or in a very weird situation. Like, most of the time, it's a slow burn. So you've got time. So you can make a new phage very quickly.
Sure, yes. Right. But again, one of the things that's sort of disappointing, though, right, is that, like, for certain people, getting in touch with somebody in Georgia and making the trip out there might be possible. Right.
But I mean, that's a huge expense.
Whilst maybe your local biohacking space should have a library of phages there, and you can merely be like, hey, will you do a quick assay and find out what's gonna eat the bacteria that's destroying my body?
I mean, in theory, but then you're dealing with, like, that's an actual infectious agent. Like, you need a BS3 lab for that to not risk infecting everybody else. That's expensive hardware. It's expensive hardware and not the sort of thing that, like, I would say your average fuckhead should be dealing with. Like,
I think that it's the sort of thing that requires a little more tender, loving care.
Yeah.
But
I mean, the thing is, I've worked in viral labs where, like, we're working with viruses and stuff, and it's not hard, but it does take some pretty specific... It
requires attentiveness.
Yeah. And hardware. Some very specific hardware and just protocol and all this kind of stuff. It's the same way that, like...
Right, so let's give it to everybody, and then... This will be less of a problem.
Right. I mean, if there was a structure for training people up to, or you know, finding people who already have that training and just giving them access to the materials, that's one thing. But I mean, when people were getting excited, like at the beginning of the COVID thing, when people were getting excited about, like, doing the test themselves, I'm like, yeah, it's a really bad idea. You should not be handling other people's samples if you don't know what you're doing. Like, it's really dumb. And, you know, there were people who were getting really excited about this. I'm like, y'all are going to get sick. Don't do this. Like, there's safe ways to do this, and y'all are not doing it that way. And I saw a lot of that, and it was really disturbing when people were way more excited than they were actually thinking through what it takes to do that responsibly and properly. And it's not to say that it's a hard thing to do per se. It's more of just, like, if you don't know what you're doing, you're going to fuck it up.
Well, again, it's one of those things to, you know, approach with some respect, yeah.
Yeah. Which, I mean, it's not to say that doing dangerous things is, you know, Not that I'm recommending people go out and do dangerous things. Fucking don't. But
I recommend people go out and do dangerous things.
But hey, that's not
perpetually.
But I mean, I also can't judge. I do dangerous things all the time. It's part of doing science. It comes with the territory. But I mean, you know, it's only dangerous if you don't understand what you're doing. If you understand the risks and you know how to mitigate them, it stops becoming dangerous. It's like nuclear tech, right? Like, everybody gets freaked out about how, like, dangerous nuclear is, except it's only dangerous if you don't know what you're doing. Like, with the right precautions, it's as safe as anything else.
Roughly speaking, I think that's a pretty good analogy, actually.
Right? Like, yeah, don't eat uranium, but, like...
Sure, yeah, there's a little more to it than that, but yeah. Well, that's a good start.
But, like, it's kind of what it is. Like, if, you know, you can handle radium, don't put it in your mouth. Like,
right, yeah.
And you know, no. Maybe wear lead gloves and you know, have a Geiger counter on. Like, there's steps you take to make these things safe. But, like, people being gung-ho about it and just going for it is how you get hurt. Like, you just got to know to take the time and learn and understand the risk and, like, ask an expert and, like, figure out the thing you're about to do, like, what are the actual problems? It's the same way, like, if you're in a chem lab, like, if you're going to use a chemical you don't know, you fucking read the MSDS, because otherwise you're like, oh, if I mix it with water, it explodes. I didn't know that. Like,
right. So, again, I think that, and I think that in, you know, bioethics and in just scientific philosophy of ethics, this isn't explained well, that often things are sort of boiled down to this rather simplistic kind of dogmatic, like, here are things you should do, here are things you shouldn't do, rather than more of a decision-making guide of saying, if you don't do this, you run the risk of these things, and you really should think about this very carefully before you do. Okay. And then that gives somebody the tools to make a good decision, like you're saying.
And I mean, to be fair, like, that one of the reasons that I'm very, like, I tend to lean into, like, before you do anything, you really need to take the time to think this through, is because I've been on the other end of that, where I didn't take the time to get, like, think things through, and I got hurt. Like, at one point, I was, like, when I was first learning chem on my own, I was trying to make sulfuric acid, because it was just hard to get. And I was heating a flask of sulfur, trying to get it to burn, except I forgot that you need air input. Like, it needed oxygen. So I was just heating sulfur in a basically sealed apparatus until it popped and sprayed molten sulfur in my face, which was not a fun experience.
Brimstone, we call that.
Yeah.
Brimstone.
Yeah, face full of brimstone is not a good way to do anything, really. So, like, this is why I always preach significant caution, because, like, I've been the dumbass kid who didn't check and didn't think these things through, and, like, you get hurt. So if you're going to do something dangerous, you really need to think these things through. And I think this kind of leads a little bit into some of the stuff that you did with the micro lab and, like people making their own medications. Like,
yeah, and the philosophy there, again, is that the way to keep people safe is by disseminating as much information as widely as possible. Right, people get hurt, like you say, when they've been deprived of access to the information that would give them the context to be able to keep themselves safe. A really tragic example of that is the story out of Mountain View, California. I don't even remember what year it was. I guess it was the early 90s, I think, where there was a guy who had manufactured some synthetic opiates poorly, and there was a side chain reaction, and he had gotten this other output, didn't realize he had, and a whole bunch of people ended up with Parkinson's symptoms overnight and went into paralysis in a matter of, you know, something like 50 hours. And a lot of people were decrying this particular drug manufacturer as like, oh, it's because he was sloppy and he didn't know what he was doing. And, oh, you know, what a a stupid rookie. And it wasn't that. What it was the information that he had gotten was from his local public library. And somebody, in an attempt to control information, had taken out, like literally cut out the pages from a section of that synthesis, saying, well, if they don't have this information, then they won't be able to make drugs, thinking that this would keep the public safe. And instead, what it did was it deprived him of the critical information to avoid that side chain reaction that ended up sending these people into paralysis.
Right.
So I think that in that regard, we need to really be very vigilant about making sure that anybody who wants to learn about science can do so as easily as possible, and that we remove as many barriers as possible in people who are wanting to study and participate, rather than having sort of a closed shop, like, oh, this is for people with letters after their names. It's right. Not. It's like,
I mean, that's kind of the beauty of like Sci-Hub, right? Like anybody can now get access to this. And it's not the edited version. It's not the like pop science version. It's the actual papers. It's this is what they did, or this is what they claim they did most of the time. How many papers have I tried to replicate that are full of shit? So many.
Yeah. But yes, Sci-Hub's wonderful. Alexandra's a friend of mine, and I have just so much respect for her. Yeah, she's just a spectacular, spectacular human being. And I can't think of anybody who's done more for the advancement of science in the past decade. And she's done more in the short time that she's been operating than most scientists do in their entire careers.
Yeah.
It's just amazing to see the result.
Yeah. I mean, I would that's one of those that's on 'cause I mean, it's really like the modern like Library of Alexandria. Like it really is as close to all of human information as we've got, basically. And I mean, there's no way I could, like, legitimately, there's no way I could do my job without Sci-Hub. Like, the number of papers that I burn through in an average day is unfathomable.
Well, I think all of us who work in science experience that. Most graduate students even rely on it, you know, just because institutional access is extraordinarily limited, even if you are associated with an institution.
And I mean, so the paper that I'm working on slowly will be the first paper that I publish. And I fully intend on citing her, like having a little thank you at the end, because there's no way that I could have done it without Sci-Hub. Like, it's not
possible. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and for those of you who are out there and, you know, have more money than you know what to do with, send all your Bitcoin to Alexandra. She deserves it.
Yeah, seriously. Oh, man, I love Sci-Hub. It's fantastic.
So it's about the top of the hour. I was going to mention one more thing about the plastics implant, but then maybe we can take a quick break and then take some questions.
Sure. Let's talk about plastic thing and then some questions. Also, just quickly before we get into that, we had two donations, one from Mark and one from the 27th, Kevin. Thank you very much for your donations. Greatly appreciated. Okay.
Did either of them have specific things they wanted to talk about?
It was just money, which, thank you. Appreciated.
Right. So the last thing that I was just going to tack on about the plastics in terms of the many various uses, one of the things that I'm specifically very excited about the possibility of is it being a new system of delivery for hormone replacement therapy. I have a lot of trans friends who are consistently nervous about their access being interrupted because legislation might change or coverage might change or pricing. And if instead of having to go to a clinic every 2 weeks or having to cash a stash or trying to get it from some other source, you could source it once, have it implanted, and then merely have it trickle into your system, and maybe you could only replace it every 5 years, this would be spectacular.
Right. I mean, no, so, that really, that does sound great.
Yeah.
I mean,
I, and I,
Like, there's, I mean, even my meds, like the ones that I'm on, I got to take them every day. If I could just get an implant and then I could just not think about it for a few years, I mean, that would be incredible. Like, it's because, I mean, for me, like, if I miss a dose, it's a fucking problem. And, like, there have been nights where I, like it's always right as you're about to fall asleep. You're like, ah, sleepy, sleepy. Oh, God, did I take my meds? And, like... Right.
Yeah, and to just be able to do away with that for so many things. I mean, it would be great to have, you know, sort of have your once or twice a decade checkup with your doctor, and your doctor's like, okay, so cool, we're going to give you an implant with this course of vitamins that you could take in pills every day, but we're just going to put an implant. We're going to give you pre-exposure prophylaxis so you won't contract HIV. Here we can give you a naloxone prodrug so you won't mistakenly overdose on opiates. And here we'll also give you something to, you know, I mean, just like just courses of treatment for all these things to just be like, yeah, let's just keep you safe. Right. And then it's not a problem. Come back in 5 years and we'll replace all of these. And then it's right. Done.
And I mean, I feel like the actual dosage on that would be a problem, like especially for vitamins and stuff. Like, the amount of stuff that you need on a daily basis is kind of high. The implant
depends
would...
on what.
I mean, so yeah, it definitely depends on.
We're working to
what.
Do one with vitamin B right now. That's sort of our test bed.
Don't you need, like,
bed.
A lot of vitamin B, though?
Well, you do, right? But that's why it's a good test bed, because the thing is there's, like, there's not really a toxic dose. I mean, like, the B2 LB50 is 10,000 milligrams per kilogram.
At that point, I think you'd drown.
Right. I mean, it's basically like, I think about the poor rat that they murdered that way, and I'm like, are you sure its stomach didn't just explode?
Yeah, I think at that point, it was just packed full from end to end with B vitamins. I don't know if it was the B vitamins that killed it. Like,
right. So, yeah. And so, anyway... But I think it would be good for a lot of vitamins. Some things, I think there might be some questions of just like packing molecular weight. But if you think about most pills that you take, most of that's buffer.
Well, yeah.
And so in terms of the volumetric of what you can pack into something that's essentially the size of a matchstick, it's pretty doable.
That's true. But I mean, when you're talking about a drug that you're taking every day, if it's 10 milligrams a day, like... It's only 100 days before you're at a gram, and a gram of the stuff is now the size of a matchstick or bigger. So, I mean, that's inherently limiting what that is. So this works better with stuff that you need very tiny amounts of. Like anything that's...
I mean, certainly that will last longer, yeah. And so there is some variability there, but I think it's a good, you know, there are a lot of good...
Well, so my point being to kind of like temper... expectations, like you're not going to get one of these that's going to be like, and it's all of your vitamins and all of your this and all of your that. Like, it would work if it's tiny amounts of all of these things, but not so good if like, also at some point it's just like, eat a fucking sandwich. Like if it for vitamins,
well, there's that,
like,
too,
eat,
right?
A fucking,
yes.
Sandwich. Like, this is right. I give a lot of biohackers shit over this. They're like, you know, I gotta kind of optimize this, and I'm like, just eat a fucking, like, just eat food. Like, and
so I think that's fair for biohackers. I think it's more of a concern if you're talking about people who live in the mountains of Nepal and don't have access to good sources of vitamin A, say,
sure,
and are having issues, sure, with their retinas breaking down because, you know.
But I mean, there's also there's other solutions to that as well, but I mean, because then you get into like,
there are always other solutions,
of course, and then you get into like golden rice, or personally my favorite, the golden beer, although it'd really be more golden
again,
Vegemite.
You're still when you work on those sorts of solutions, which are also quite promising, you're still talking about an infrastructural solution, right? So you have to have
I mean, these are all these are all infrastructural solutions. Even an implant, like, because then you got to have the infrastructure.
Well, maybe not.
Sort of.
So yes, but the thing is that instead of saying, okay, now we have to change the agricultural production in a country for a single person to be able to say, well, if I could just get a large amount of pharmaceutical grade vitamin A and some EVA plastic and an extruder, I could make an implant that would keep me safe while I go live in the mountains where there isn't a good source of vitamin A.
I mean, if
that's one of the things that's appealing to me is
right, being but in, able to in that look at some particular of
these solutions that make it able for an individual to act independently,
right,
rather than consistently having solutions that require a whole group of people to agree, and instead having a certain measure of bodily autonomy where you have people who are able to take responsibility for their own health on that individual level and, you know, eat some vegetables, take a walk, get some sleep, drink some water. Yeah, all the OG biohacking things that are important. And then on top of that, being able to do some augmentative things that might be optimizing for particular situations.
Right. Okay, so just quickly, we had a couple of questions and donations. So first things first, thank you to Mildly Feasible Philip Cern. Sorry if I mispronounced your name. There's an interesting accent on that. And Gavin Mayers. Okay, so a couple of questions. Let's see if I can get this one first. So first question was, how can an electrical engineering major get involved with bioengineering? And do you know Dr. Buckingham? Study head at Stanford for diabetics.
So is that a question for you or for me?
For you. That's for you. It says, does Dr.
Buckingham does Dr. Laufer know Stanford?
No, Dr. Buckingham.
I what's Dr. Buckingham's first name? I mean, I can.
It just says Dr. Buckingham. That's all I got, man.
Okay. So not offhand, I know some people at Stanford. Let's see if I can just look up who this is. Dr. Buckingham at Stanford. Bruce Buckingham, is that who this is?
Dinner? Looks like he's something about diabetics.
Pediatric endocrinologist. So looking at
that sounds right.
Yeah, all right. So let's see what we can see here. So
I think it's a resounding no, you don't know them.
No, so this is not a guy that I'm I have run into. That to be fair, I haven't, you know, my interaction with the diabetic community is mostly through the Open Insulin Project.
Right.
And a little bit through the artificial pancreas project. I really don't do a lot of work in, you know, that type of endocrinology because it's being handled by so many brilliant people so well.
Speaking of open insulin, I do hope to have some of the open insulin people on a stream at some point.
They're all really brilliant people, and like that's the number one thing that I get queries about. People will write to Four Thieves and say, "Hey, what about insulin?" I say, there's some really smart people.
I get the same.
Go talk to Open Insulin.
I get the same constantly. Yeah. They're like every time I do a bio video, they're like, "Can you do insulin? Can you do insulin? Can you do insulin?" I'm like, "No, I can't. Right. There's other people doing insulin."
Right.
Okay. So we had another question. So the one question was for me is, when are you going to do your next brain cheese video? When the pandemic fucks off, is the nicest way I can put that. I had the brain cheese thing. It was planned for July. It's not July, evidently, and that didn't happen. So I had planned on flying to Indiana and having Applied Science help me with that. It was going to be fun, but that's been delayed until traveling it to the South is not a death sentence. The other question was, do you think we will have implants with automatic diagnostic systems and drug deployment in near future? And then they asked mainly for preventing heart attacks. I think if you're having a heart attack, it's a more complex problem than an implant will fix it.
Well, there are some ideas surrounding that, but we need to go back one because there was somebody who was asking about getting into biohacking from an electrical engineering standpoint. Can you read that one again?
Sure. how can an electrical engineer major get involved with bioengineering?
Well, I mean, I would say first, study well and look at the literature. Biomedical engineering is sort of a specialty, right? That's something that you would specialize in graduate school. But if you're already in school for electrical engineering, try and see if there's anybody at your institution or at nearby institutions, or now that we're all isolated in faraway institutions, who'd be willing to talk to you about the sort of stuff that they're doing.
Yeah, and I mean, it's one of those things that, like, there's always somebody who needs an electrical engineer, especially in bioengineering. Like, everything they do, at some point, they're going to make a machine to do the thing. They're going to need an EE. So it's...
Right. And so, yeah, if you're good at what you do, especially if you're, you know, if you're doing hardware, if you're the sort of person that somebody can be like, hey, I need this thing designed and built, and you can be like, yeah, I can do that, and you build the electronics and, you know, send away for the boards, and then this gets made and somebody just needs to, like, code it and implant it, you're going to be an invaluable resource to right. So that would be a good start, and there's plenty of good literature on there about ways that electronics have to be specially designed when they're designed for something that's going to live inside something that's still living.
Yeah, I mean, even the brain cheese thing is actually another great example. Like, that is fundamentally mixing bio and electronics. Like, I've got a guy who's now developing all of the electronics to interface with the neurons, because you can't just stick a voltmeter on there and hope for the best. Like, it actually requires specialized electronics and circuits, which are outside of my realm of expertise. So I look to an EE. It's really just a matter of, if you want to get involved, just find people doing cool stuff.
I was just going to say be solicitous, because people tend to want to talk about what they're doing. These are very busy people, so try and be patient. If it takes a while to get back to you, if it takes several attempts of talking to people before they get back to you, but you know, if you're interested, there are people who will support you and be available if you're available.
So we just had a couple of donations. Just want to address them really quickly. Hirasha, thank you very much. And a Merry Festivus to you too. Logan K, thank you very much. He says, I dig holes and look at old bones for a living. I understand maybe 2/3 of this. I'm just here for the science. Well, thanks for hanging out. And so we had that one other question. I think we already kind of addressed it, which was the implants for diagnostics and such.
Oh, right. The implants for diagnostics. So I've seen... So some of the people who were previously with Grindhouse Wetware and then were working with on the Abetavet project with Livestock Labs actually were developing predictive algorithms so that you could see some of the events leading up to a heart attack. Not that you'd have like, oh, you're going to have a heart attack tomorrow, but maybe like you're going to have a heart attack in the next hour potentially, that could send, I don't know about automated drug deployment, but something that could certainly send an alert to like...
Man, that'd be scary. Like, you get an alert on your phone, just so you know, you're going to have a heart attack. What?
But like, right. But I mean, it's like, if you get some sort of alert, like, hey, you need to get somebody else to drive a car to get you to see some medical assistance immediately, drop what you're doing and leave now. Like, that's much better than waiting to see somebody, you know, faint and then having to figure out what's going wrong.
Yeah.
So I am guardedly optimistic about the possibilities of that, especially since that can happen even with something like, a wearable that is monitoring stuff like your heartbeat and your blood oxygen saturation and a few other things that can be done non-invasively. And if you have a little more data, then of course you can interpolate more. I hope for that a lot, especially in the geriatric realm, where there are people that in an ideal scenario, you'd be keeping a very close eye on, but maybe you can't. And if you had some sort of an automated system, if there were, you know, and an implantable is a good system for that because it's something that somebody doesn't have to remember to put on, or, and hopefully it's very low maintenance and it can send something to primary caretaker to say.
I hope it's low maintenance. If it's high maintenance, you got to be opening yourself up all the time. That's a problem.
Well, I meant high maintenance in terms of something that needs to be charged all the time, or something that needs to be pinged or checked on regularly. But if you have something that operates fairly independently and works basically only when it needs to, low current draw, you know, a long lifetime, then you can have something that would, you can put in like an octogenarian and say like, cool, you know, I mean, I'm down the street and I won't be knocking on your door every day to bother you, but if this thing pings me, I'll come running.
Right. I mean, that would be great. Okay, we had a couple more questions and donations, so let's just address those quickly. Dan Chicola says, get some lab supplies from an E. Thank you very much. Greatly appreciate it. Slight Cynic asks, I'm curious about both of your takes about self-teaching. For example, how would a self-taught person in a field compare to a person with formal education, or how difficult is, or what is the hardest part of teaching yourself?
Oh, well, this is a great topic. I find in my experience that oftentimes people who are self-taught have a broader view of things, because instead of having been spoon-fed a sort of pre-packaged idea of how a field should be approached, they've had to sort of construct it for themselves. Self-teaching is something that you need to bring a lot of energy to, but I don't know of anybody who's had the want to's, as I like to call them, who hasn't been able to. Information's out there. You know, in times past, digging up the information is the hard part. Currently, we have an overabundance of information, so it's sorting out the garbage information. It's the greater part of the task currently. There are
also finding the information that isn't written down. Like, there's definitely, so this was something that I found in my self-teaching journey, was, so one of my biggest concerns when it comes to self-teaching is the holes. Like, it's like you end up with these people with very broad skill sets who have, you know, learned all these interesting things trying to get up to date, but they'll have these very weird holes in their knowledge just because they didn't go through like the prepackaged version, whereas the people in the prepackaged version have different holes.
Right. It's a different set of holes, and they show up in different places.
So, I mean, really, the ideal for me, the ideal is you do some of the prepackaged and some on your own, which is what I did. Like, I did a little bit of uni, and it definitely taught me some stuff that there's no way I would have learned on my own. And also, for me, the value of university isn't the classes, and it's not the people, it's the labs. Like, if it's really getting into the labs and being able to like have somebody hold your hand as you're working with these frankly very expensive pieces of equipment, and like learning how to use them, and like, you know, drilling those skills of like taking good notes. Like, the thing that kills me is a lot of the people who are self-taught are shit at taking notes, and so like they'll do something really cool, and then being able to replicate it's really hard because they didn't write it down.
That's a mistake you make once.
Yeah. Well, that's the problem. It's not. It's a mistake they make over and over and over and over again until eventually it sinks in. And I say they. I'm guilty of this. It took me a while of fucking it up before eventually I was like, okay, you gotta write it down. And like,
documentation is certainly a thing. So I can speak to this as well, having had an overabundance of formalized education, and
you're not a doctor. You've got a whole PhD.
I do. I don't recommend it. I mean, unless your ego and your bank account needs a really big dent, both, then it's no better way to take care of that problem.
Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of work for two letters.
Three letters. But yeah.
Three?
PhD?
Doctor. D-D-R.
Well, and then in that case, it's five letters because it's doctor and DR and PhD. But yeah, anyway, like,
handful of letters.
Right. So having letters before and after your name is good for getting people who don't think very carefully to take you seriously.
Yeah. I mean, that there's, but, I've had instances where people just, like, I say I don't have a degree and I'm just like dead. Like, they just turn right, and walk away.
And I've had the reverse experience where people are like, oh, Dr. Laufer. And I'm like, you don't know if I know anything.
Right.
Why do you say that with reverence? That's ridiculous.
Right. I mean, it's when you get a PhD, it means you're an expert at one incredibly specific thing.
It means you might be.
You might be. That's true. Right. Like, even
there
somebody
are
who's
plenty,
like,
of people with PhDs who really.
Oh, no.
Got it.
I'm aware. Yeah. There's a lot of really dumb PhDs. It's a thing. Yeah.
Stuff. Back to the self-teaching thing. The strategy that I recommend is to take the inverted approach from what happens in a traditional learning environment. In a traditional structured learning environment, you start with some very basic basics. You then build on those, and then you build on those, and then some very long time later, if you've had the fortitude to stick it out, you may or may not see the thing that you were originally interested in that got you into it in the first place.
Yeah.
And by then, you're probably burnt out and depressed anyway.
Or you have the very specific personality where you're just like, give me more. In which case,
right. For you. But I mean, if you're that person, you're probably not, you know, listening to us.
Right. I mean, that was like, I remember the first day I wrote down, like, you know, ideas for how to make spider silk in my notebook, and like just kept at it for years until I did it. Like, it's a thing. It takes a specific amount of drive and a small amount of insanity to think that, like, it's a good idea, and like sticking with it and not getting disheartened, and it's really just sticking with it. Like, more than anything, it's just like learning an instrument, right? Like, if you're learning the guitar, it doesn't take very long to like figure out how to play Yankee Doodle, but to like play an actual thing that is good, the only way to do it is time. It's just time and practice and effort. Like, there's no shortcut.
Again, what I recommend structurally is to sort of invert the model that you normally get. So instead of saying, and again, you know, same thing works for reversing, you know, teaching yourself music or anything else. Instead of saying, okay, look, don't do anything, sit and practice scales for a year, and then we'll work on chord melodies, and then we'll... So here's what you do. If there's something that inspires you and you want to get into it, say you want to do something like immeasurably complicated, right? You want to cure diabetes or cancer or whatever, or you want to replicate some incredibly complicated gene therapy. Start with that. Get the most complicated book or paper on that and open it up and start reading it, and you'll hit a wall real fast because that stuff that you normally would have been put through to get you there isn't present. So fine, right? That's fine. You hit that wall, and then you find the thing that you need to figure out in order to be able to read that first chapter or first paragraph or last chapter or last paragraph. And so then you go and get another source that's not quite as complicated, that's going to give you that predecessor material.
Right. And just work.
You're going to read through that, and you're going to hit another wall, because even that is going to have antecedent things that you haven't been exposed to yet. And you keep working your way down until eventually you're mucking around with the beginning stuff that the structured learning environment would have started you with. Here's the difference. You now know why you need that beginning stuff and what that's going to lead to and what it's going to lead to and how that's eventually going to get you to start working on the thing that you wanted in the first place, as opposed to this, like, hold your breath for 6 to 12 years and then maybe you'll start to be able to get to what you were interested in the beginning.
I mean, this is actually where we agree completely, because that was that, like, when I talk about, like, you know, teaching yourself to use that, I say literally the exact same thing. Like, pick the hardest thing you can think of and just go for it. Like, I mean, for me, the first project that I ever went for was building a fusion reactor, which is ridiculously difficult when you know nothing. And, you know, just working backwards to figure out, okay, where am I getting stuck, right? Like, where's the hole? Now, again, then this kind of loops back into the safety stuff we talked about earlier, because the one problem with this is you might not anticipate dangers as you're, if you actually attempt to, like, work through some of this stuff. So that's where it really is. If you're going to do this, you just got to make sure that you're being thorough, and not, don't go too, like, don't get too gung-ho and, like, really just attempt a thing without also taking the time to make sure you understand what it is you're trying to do deeply, because you can get hurt. But that's not to discourage you from experimenting and trying and doing things. It's just, if you're going to do a thing, do it properly. But, you know, that's just a matter of taking the time to learn what doing it properly entails. And that's just work through it step by step. Make sure you kind of know the gist of what's going on, and also, like, when you're, like, self-learning, asking an expert is totally valid. Like, asking people is a,
oh yeah,
not only is it totally valid, it's encouraged, and it's something that should be part of your process. Like, ask people smarter than you. Like, ask people with the experience who could give you those tidbits of, like, hey, by the way, if you cross those two wires, things go kaboom. Like,
yeah, absolutely. And the thing is that generally, if you're self-taught and you're excited and you go to an expert and you explain what you're doing, what you're trying, you're going to get one of two reactions. The more common reaction is, oh, that's great, let me show you a few tricks that are going to make a whole lot of things a whole lot easier. And it's going to cause a quantum leap in your abilities to be able to do stuff. Or you're going to get somebody who's going to tell you, like, you really shouldn't be doing this sort of thing. If you get the latter, walk away.
Yeah.
Those are terrible, terrible people who basically are going to try to belittle you to inflate their own ego. And I don't know if we use curse words on your channel, but I have a good mind to use a lot of very rude terminology to describe those sorts of people. But if you come across a real scientist, they're going to throw in and give you a lot of good tips and support. Yeah.
Although, I mean,
till you need it. Like, dig in, get into the weeds. When you get to the point where you hit a wall that's severe enough that digging around isn't garnering you a whole lot, go find somebody, and then you'll be ready to absorb all the good stuff they're going to be able to throw your way.
Yeah, and also, I mean, there is a line, though. Like, I get a lot of emails, like, a lot. And sometimes...
As do I.
And some people will ask things like, how do I do this? And sometimes the only responsible answer is don't. Like, just fucking,
well,
don't. Like,
you and I differ a little bit there. I don't think I'd ever say that.
There are certain, like, there aren't many things where I'll just be like, just fucking don't. For me, the ones that I usually hit that wall are, I want to genetically modify myself to produce hormones of some kind. I'm like, just don't, you'll die. Don't do it. Like nobody's done this success. Like, it's not even that nobody independent's done this. Nobody has done this successfully and in a way that isn't extremely dangerous. Just don't do it. It's a bad idea. Like, so that's kind of like, I have very few things where I'll be like, just don't. Like, you literally don't have the ability to do this safely, because nobody does. Like, this is, you'd have to spend 10 years testing this on mice before you'd even think about attempting it on a human, because it's just not safe.
I understand, and you and I operate in slightly different realms, so I think that maybe the risk profile is a little bit different as well. But this might not be safe for you to do, but, like, you know, if you want to destroy your body, if you think that that risk is worth taking, that it's more likely that you won't survive it, but this is something that you're going to do, like, that's an independent personal decision, and I don't think it's my place to tell somebody to not do anything.
I mean, that's fair. For me, I would feel responsible if I explained how to do it. Because the thing is, like, when people ask me that, I'm like, oh, I could absolutely tell you how to do it. I'm just not going to, because, like, then I'd feel responsible if you actually did it. If you're so inclined to do that, like, the information is out there and it's not actually hard to find. So if you care, go ahead and look, but I'm not going to participate. Whereas there's certain things where, like, they're going to do it anyway. And it's one of those, if you give the advice, then they're more likely to not hurt themselves. Then, like, I'm more inclined to, help. But, like, there's certain things I'm like, I cannot see a way that you're going to do this without it ending up with you dead. Then I'm just going to tell you not to do it, because it's not a good idea. And I'll explain that. And I'm not just going to be like, just don't do it. I'll be like from a you know, professional perspective, I cannot actually think of a safe way to do this that isn't going to end up with you dead. And here's why. So, you know, consider not.
I think consider not is a fair piece of advice. And being like, here are a bunch of ways that you could kill yourself. This is worth reconsidering. Yeah. I mean, again,
like, unless that's your goal, in which case there's far less painful ways to die.
But maybe not garnering as quality of data.
Yeah, but you're also not going to generate good data either.
There are trade-offs in everything, and I think it's important to remember.
Yeah, other than, you know, the fanciest Darwin Award of the year. Okay, we had a couple more questions and donations, so I just want to address them really quickly.
Cool. So let's address those, and I think we're about out of time.
Yeah, so this will be the last one. So just quickly, Toonie Poo, nice username, donated. Thank you very much. Greatly appreciated. There was no question or anything accompanied with that. And then the final one before we wrap up is throwing in a couple bucks because I want to know more about the cyberpunk-esque implant. Are there any open source plans, blueprints, etc.? And how do I get more info? Contact someone for more info. So I think they're asking about Pegleg.
So if you go to pegleg.org, we have sort of an outline as to how we built the Gen 2 version, the one that's in my leg. We're hoping to have a Gen 3 version out next year. Which will be accessible through, you know, other channels. So that's possible as well. And if you're actually hell bent on building a peg leg beyond the details that are in the webpage, there is a little contact form that you can use if you want more information.
Okay, very cool. And then super duper finally, this is just, I've seen this go by a couple of times in the chat. It's basically, you know, is the Pfizer vaccine safe? In my opinion, yeah, it is. And you should get it when it's available.
Yeah, so a lot of people have been asking me about vaccines lately. It's like, oh, and the short answer is, having any vaccine is better than having no vaccine.
Yeah, and it's better than the actual virus.
Right. The slightly more complicated thing to realize is that the term vaccine means a lot of different things, and it implies a lot of different things, and that's kind of in-depth and complicated to get into.
Right.
But because it's an umbrella term, right? There are various things that give you various levels of protection over various timelines with various different mechanisms, and they're all kind of different. But any measure of protection is better. And the like in terms of safe, like, okay, in the very worst case, it's possible that you can have some allergic reactions to certain things, but it's not dangerous.
It's not,
it might not be like super pleasant, but it's going to be a whole lot more pleasant than, of course, you know.
I think there have been one instance or two instances of an allergic reaction to it, but it's super rare. Like super duper duper rare. And even then, like, it's manageable. One of those
things, right.
It's an allergic reaction. It goes away after a couple of minutes. And if worst case, you got to take a little bit of like antihistamines or something, and then you're fine. Yeah. Like, and you're still better off than having the virus. So yes. And also all the data points to it being extremely safe, and you know, it's worth it. I think if there's,
the thing to think about is like, you know, do your own research, make your own decision, but just make sure that when you're thinking about it, that your rhetoric is sound. You wouldn't ever swim through a toxic river full of angry crocodiles who are really hungry because you weren't sure if the bridge was up to spec, right? And right. This is sort of like, that's the logic that you're dealing with. And it's easy to fall into, right? It's really easy to fall into, to be like, oh, I don't know about the vaccine. I don't know if it's safe. That's a natural fear to have if you don't have a lot of data. Right. The data's out there. Dig into it. Make your own decision.
It's fairly public. Like, it's not hard to find.
Most of it is, yeah. There are a couple ones that are notably not, which does bother me. Right. But roughly speaking, again, make your own decision, but make sure that you're making a decision based on a logical chain rather than sort of an emotional base of like, I'm not sure. Again, think of the metaphor of, you know, the toxic river full of landmines and water mines and angry animals that are trying to kill you versus a bridge, which might or might not be up to spec. I mean, which would you pick?
I'm taking the bridge. On that topic, like, as soon as the vaccine's available, I intend on taking it. I mean, technically I have taken a vaccine already, but I'm still going to take the commercially available one because I want to be damn sure. I don't want to get sick. Like,
yeah, I mean, I'm certainly
seen my spacesuit video. I am a nutcase. I don't want to get sick. Like,
and I'm lucky because in Singapore, the government just bought enough vaccines to cover everyone in the country, and it's being given out for free.
Yeah, so, in Canada, it's free as well. It's going to take them a while to get enough for everybody. Oh, but
Canada.
Yeah, where medicine's not ridiculous, mostly, with notable exceptions. That'd be a very weird national anthem. Anyway,
Before we wrap up, to just tell everybody who's still watching, thanks for tuning in, and that... At Four Thieves, we're continuously in a recruiting cycle. If you're interested in potentially getting involved, there's a contact us form on fourthievesvinegar.org.
And there's a link in the description, by the way.
I appreciate that. Get in touch if you're interested and want to be part of it.
For today's show, thank you everybody who donated. Greatly appreciated. And everybody who tuned in. Like I said, this is the last stream for the year, and in the new year, streams will be moved onto a second channel, but there'll be a dedicated announcement for that. Links to everything can be found in the description. Be sure to check out...
Oh, yeah, I'm also on Twitter if anybody wants to get in touch on a public forum.
There's a link to his Twitter in the description as well. So links in the description, everything can be found down there. Thank you everybody for hanging out, this has been a lot of fun. And I will see you in the new year. Happy holidays. Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa. Merry Festivus. All the things. And I will see you.
Happy plague. Stay safe.
Happy plague. Yeah.
And keep your fellow humans safe. Indeed. And don't spread disease.
Yes, indeed. And that's all for today.